Hello everyone, today I want to show you my mechanical calculator. And we're going to learn how it works, we're going to learn how to do some calculations on it, and we're also going to learn about one of its kind of strange quirks, and hopefully get used to dealing with that a little bit. So first we're going to do a really simple calculation. So down here at the bottom, we've got our input sliders. We can slide these up and down to input different numbers. Here's the thousands place, the hundreds place. We're just gonna start down here at the ones place, and we're gonna set our input slider to 3. Now looking at the output, that comes on these wheels on the top here. So where this green and then the black piece point, that is what our output is reading right now. So we're at 0, 0, 0, 0. We're gonna turn this crank. And when we made a full rotation, you can see that our output is 3. Now to do 3 plus 3, we've already entered 3 here on the input slider. So all we gotta do is turn the crank again. And sure enough, 3 plus 3 is 6. The rest of them are still at 0. Okay, now we're gonna do 6 plus 3, that should be 9. Let's see what happens. Okay, something a little bit strange has happened. We still have 0, 0 here, but then we have 1 and 1. So we got 11. Now, 6 plus 3 is not usually 11, usually 9. However, we notice that something is missing over here, right? We have the digits 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but we don't have 8 and we don't have 9. So it's sort of unreasonable to think we could get an answer of 9 when we don't even have a 9 on the dial. And the fact that we have these 8 digits means that this calculator does not represent numbers in our familiar base 10 system. We have 10 fingers, we like to count to 10, but instead represents them in base 8. Okay, so my favorite way to explain base 8 is with something called an exploding dot machine. It looks like this. We've got some boxes here. Since we're dealing with base 8, we're going to want to use an 8-to-1 machine, and here's how it works. Whenever there is our 8 dots, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 dots are going to explode and make 1 dot in the next box over. So in particular here, we just did 3 plus 3 plus 3, which should be 9, so let's put 9 dots in our 8-to-1 machine. Now, 8 of those are going to explode. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and make 1 dot in the next box over. So that leaves 1 dot right here, 1 dot here, 1 dot here, which we can really read as 11, just like our machine said. Okay, so now that we figured out that 11 in base 8 really is 9 in base 10, we're going to add 3 a few more times. So we've already entered our 3 in the input slider. Now we're just going to turn the crank to add another 3. So 11 plus 3 is 14. We add another 3. And we get 17. And we add another 3. We get 22. Okay, so coming back to our 8-to-1 machine to check this answer, we just did 9 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3, which is 18. So if we put 18 dots in this box, now we're going to do our explosion. So 8 of these dots are going to make 1 explosion. So there's 3, 6, 8, 3, 6, 8. So we had 2 explosions. That leaves 2 dots left over, which we can write as 2, 2, or 22. Okay, next we're gonna isolate some components of this machine to better understand how they work, and then we'll see how they all work together after that. So here, this staircase looking thing that spins around is called a Leibniz wheel after Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Here is our input slider. Let's slide that all the way down as far as it can go. And we'll manually just set it to zero here. So now when we turn the crank for the Leibniz wheel, nothing at all happens. This thing is so low that none of the teeth are going to engage with any of these rods in this sort of staircase design. So now if we move it up a few inches, now it's going to engage with 1, 2, 3, 4 of those steps in the staircase. And we can see at the top, that is going to move us 4 ticks on the output dial. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 more ticks, and then 4 ticks to get back to 0, 2, 3, 4. Each tick is moving us 1/8 of a turn. So the most complicated part of this machine by far is the carrying mechanism, and this is one really critical component to it. What we've got here is this one tooth, this one rod, and it just sort of rotates harmlessly. Not doing anything, right? Not engaging with any gears. Certainly not rotating this little arrow on the top. However, when we lift this spring mechanism, and so the spring can either be in the down position or the up position, it in turn lifts this this gear. And when this gear, when the spring is in the up position and this thing comes around, it is gonna rotate our gear 1/8 of a turn each time. But if the spring is in the down position, nothing's gonna happen. So basically when we carry, we want this to be in the up position. We want to advance it 1/8 of a turn, and then we want to send it back to the down position, and that's exactly what's gonna happen on the big machine. All right, finally, no calculator would be complete without a clear button. And that's what this machine demonstrates. So we can arrange these arrows any way we like, but no matter what we do when we go to turn this wheel, they all point back towards the middle. So we can try that again. We'll do, pick some other arrangement. And then when we go to turn the wheel, when we're done, they all turn back to the middle. And this is because they are missing one tooth right here. And so that means that when these white rods engage the other teeth, there's nothing more to engage with because that tooth is missing. And the gear won't turn any further than its, you know, its home position pointing toward the center of the circle. Alrighty, so Kurt Herzstock, Austrian engineer, put all of these ideas together in the 1940s to design his Curta calculator, which went into production after he was liberated from Buchenwald. And he has had some more features as well. Having taken a look at those mechanisms, we're gonna find them in the calculator. So we'll start over here at the top with our clear mechanism. Right now we're still reading 22 from earlier. We're gonna take our clearing mechanism, and that moves those output dials back to zero. Now we're gonna enter the number 2023 into our input sliders. So we have a 2 there, we have nothing there, we have 0, and then we need a 2 here, and this is already at 3. So we can see the Leibniz wheel in action here, rotating those input gears, and when we made a full rotation, we'll check at the top and see that we have 2023. Okay, now we're gonna add 27 to that number. So this is going to be back at zero. And we are going to set our input slider up to 7. So we're going to turn the crank, and then we're going to see the carry mechanism in action. So pay close attention to this sort of lime green pin. It pushed down on this part of this lever, which in turn moved this spring up. All right, so if I push down on the lever, the spring goes up. And that's exactly what that green pin just did. When the spring goes up, we see this gear move along with it. And now we're gonna look at this white piece right here and how it engages with those silver blue teeth. It turned that gear 1/8 of a turn. And now if we follow this this yellow piece over here, it is going to be pushed back down, which is going to reset the spring to get ready for a subsequent carry. And then we've made it one full turn, as we can see at the bottom. We get 2,052. Okay, we're gonna do one more kind of calculation with this contraption. First, we're gonna clear it. And then we're gonna do some multiplication by repeated addition, which is exactly what the Curta calculator does as well. The Knurta calculator can do it too. Instead of using this input as a thousands place, we're gonna use it as a counter, just keep track of how many repeated additions we've done. We're gonna set this back to 0, and we're gonna do the sevens times table. So we've entered a 7 here at the bottom. When we go to turn the crank, we'll get 7. And over here, we have a 1 indicating that we've done that one time. So 1 times 7 equals 7. Now we'll turn the crank again. We see some carrying going on. And our output reads 16. We've done that twice, so 2 times 7 is 16. Three times 7 is 25. 4 times 7 is 34. 5 times 7 is 43. 6 times 7 is 52. 5 times 7 is 52. And finally, we see that 7 times 7 is 61. So anyway, that's pretty much it for this calculator. Please let me know if you have any questions in the comments, and I hope you enjoyed learning about it. I'll send you off with the calculator counting by 2.